या मदान निरादेव या प्रदीप विजय कुमार Navya has come in, Rakshita, Sumant, Chaitra, Prasanna Kumar, they are there now, who else has come, are you able to hear me? Yeah, you're all there. I am finding 7 students joining the session as of now. Navya, Prasan, Rakshita, Sumant, Chaitra, Pradeep, who is Madan, Sumant. Sumant, I think first time you have attended this class.
Yes, sir. Attend Maridre.
Ella class attend Maridre.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Prasanna Kumar has joined now. It is 11:58. Let us wait for 2 minutes and then start the class. Seven out of 65 students are. Joining now. Pooja Joshi is joining now. Pooja Joshi and Rakshita Hepar. 9. Ramya has joined now. Then anybody else? Rashmi Kotihal, Ashika Jain, Rupa Nayak, Nishant, can you hear me? Nishant? Hello, he's still connecting to audio. Unmute your audios. Unmute your audios and videos. I have unmuted all. Rachana Mandra is joining now. Fourteen now. Anybody else making it now? Deepika is joining. All these are getting recorded. That's why I am putting your names. Yeah. Unmute your videos. Unmute. Is it difficult? I have unmuted all. You can unmute yourself. Ganesh Rao has joined now. Ganesh Rao, Can you hear me, Ganesh?
Yes, sir, I can hear you.
Ashwini Bhatt has joined now. Nikhil has joined now. 18. Now, number is 18. Anybody else whom I have not named?
Sir, Ashika.
Ashika, I told. Ashika, I have noted. Ashika is okay.
Sir, Nikhil Amich.
Nikhil, I have told. Who is this home?
Sir, Rachana Mandre.
Rachana Mandre, I have noted. Nishant, Rupa, Sumant, Chaitra, Ashwini, Navya, Madan, Ashika, Nikhil. Srimanta has joined. Rakshita, Rashmi, Puja Joshi, Sumant, Rashmi Kotihad, Ganesh Rao, Puja SS. So 21 now. Number is 4. It's already. Deepika is there. Rupa Nayak is there. Anybody else? 22. Who has joined now? So, 3 months. Rajesh has joined. Rajesh, can you hear me?
Rajesh? Sir, yes, sir.
Ah,
yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Be there. 22. Number is far, far less. Just 1/3. I don't know what is preventing others from them. Sri Vidya is joining. Sharanya is joining now. Where are your other two friends, Sharanya? Where is Srivani? Sri Vidya? You have left her behind in Mathur. Twenty-four. It is 12:03. Let me wait for another 2 minutes and then start. Okay. Hello. You are able to hear me, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Right. 24. I want to see that magic figure of 65. Just one day. Neha Kausar and Divya have just now joined. So the number must be 26. Ganesh Raikar is there. Akash has come in. Akash Barge, right? Is it Barge? Akash Barge. What the time? Akash. It is number 27. Good. It is adding up slowly. No walk-ins. Divya, Srividya, Akash, Ashika, Jain, Prasanna, Ramina, Deepika. 27, it is still 27. I want another 4 to start the class. No, what? 5. It is 12:05, let me start the class, okay? Yeah. Now, having completed 3 units in corporate valuation, that is the first one, the overview of corporate valuation plus the enterprise DCF method. Then in the second unit, non-DCF methods of valuation plus relative valuation method. And in the third unit, we noted certain very important advanced issues in valuation. So, having completed 3 units, so the number is 30 now. Who has joined just now? Srivani has joined. Who else? Vikas has joined. I think those two are the new additions. But Vidyashri has come in. Good. 30. Now the number is 30. So, having completed these three units, that means 50% of the curriculum of corporate valuation, I mean the theoretical part. Now let's move over to unit 4. Unit 4 was not there earlier in the earlier curriculum. It has been introduced afresh in your curriculum. This is about strategic financing the decisions. Let me share the screen. Let me show the PPTs. Yeah. Are you able to see this slide? Are you able to see this slide?
No, sir.
It's there now. It is appearing on your screen.
Yes, sir.
Now.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
This is the strategic financing decisions. Let me explain the important words there. You find three words there, strategic financing decisions. You are aware, as students of financial management, that financial management involves three important decisions by the organization through its financial management division. These three decisions are: first one, financing decisions; second one, investment decisions; third one, dividend decisions. The entire finance management revolves around these three decisions. Please note, this is a basic info. This is not any advanced concept of matter. There are three important decisions involved in financial management or in corporate finance. One is financing decisions, second one is investment decisions, third one is dividend decisions. Never forget these three things. Now, but mute your audio, mute your audios. Yeah. Now, what are these financing decisions? Financing decisions refer to the decisions taken by the firm or the company with respect to financing its operations. Financing its operations. An organization requires funds, you are aware, to establish and run its operations. Without funds, without finance, an organization cannot run. So it has to mobilize, it has to raise the required funds or required finance. How does an organization go about raising or mobilizing the funds or finance required for its investment, or investment in fixed assets and investment in current assets, is all about financing decisions. So please be very clear, financing decisions refer to the organizations or the company's decisions and actions with respect to raising capital, raising funds, raising finance required for investment in fixed assets and current assets, which are required to establish and run an organization. Without investment in fixed assets, without investment in current assets, no organization can hope to establish itself and run its organization. So funds are required for these two. Having raised the funds, having raised the capital, how does the organization invest these funds in fixed assets and current assets are the part of this next decision, the investment decisions. We are not going to look into this. We are going to look into the first set of decisions, that is financing decisions. How does an organization raise the capital required, raise the funds or the money required to finance its various operations? So they are financing decisions. Now, these financing decisions could be of two types. One is operational financing decisions. Second one is strategic financing decisions. Operational financing decisions refer to the decisions made by an organization with respect to raising the working capital, with respect to raising the funds required for short term, say 1 year to 2 years. required to for investment in current assets, to required to required for running its day-to-day operations. They are operational financing decisions. So these are routine financing decisions. The company raises the funds required for its working capital, you know, through or from the banks or through various money market instruments. So that is separate. We are not talking about this. In this unit of corporate valuation, we are talking about the other set of financing decisions, that is strategic financing decisions. Strategic financing decisions refer to long-term financing decisions. Financing decisions having a long-term impact, long-term presence, long-term influence on the organization. Which are the long-term financing decisions? Financing decisions with respect to raising long-term capital. Financing decisions which refer to long-term capital are called strategic financing decisions. They are strategic because they are very significant. They affect the valuation of the company. They affect the future of the company. They affect the growth of the company. So they are called very significant or strategic financing decisions. So what decision an organization takes with respect to raising its long-term capital or strategic financing. What are these long-term capital? We have two important components of long-term capital or strategic capital. They are, one is equity, another one is debt. So we are coming to this final financing mix of capital structure of an organization. How does an organization constructs its capital structure is the crux of strategic financing decisions. So strategic financing decisions refer to the organization's decisions with respect to its capital structure, with respect to raising equity and debt, or with respect to raising long-term capital. So this is the introduction to this unit. So strategic financing decisions do not involve financing decisions with respect to operational financing decisions like working capital financing. They refer to the raising of capital, that is constructing an appropriate optimum capital structure for the organization by raising appropriate amounts of debt, appropriate amounts of equity. In what ratio, in what proportion this debt and equity are raised by the organization with an eye on the valuation of the company. There are arguments, as we see in the latter part of this unit, there are arguments which say this capital structure or the financing decisions do not affect the value of the company. So an organization can go for any ratio, any proportion. There is nothing like optimum capital structure or optimum financing decision. Whereas another set of authors propose that the capital structure or the financing decision, the long-term or the strategic financial decisions affect the value of the company, hence they have to be taken very carefully. There is what is called an optimum capital structure, and the organization should strive to reach or construct that capital structure, maintain that capital structure, maintain that proportion of debt and equity. So that is also there. So both the arguments are there. No final word has been told till now. So that is the thing, that is what we need to understand at this stage. Now let me move to the contents of this unit. So these four issues are involved in this unit. They are valuation and financing decisions in ideal capital markets, capital structure and value in a perfect world, information asymmetry, and share buyback and valuation. So these four issues are required to be studied in this unit. The first one is valuation and financing decisions in an ideal capital market. Let's disintegrate this concept in capital market. You know, capital market is that part of the financial market from where organizations, companies raise long-term capital in the form of debt and equity. So they are capital markets. What is an ideal capital market? An ideal capital market, of course, it is only in textbooks, it is only for academic interest. Or an ideal capital market is where there is perfect competition. All the players, whether lenders or the users, have the same information. There is no information asymmetry. Everybody knows everything about the lenders, users, the financial market conditions, situation, etc., etc. It is only an ideal, hypothetical capital market. In such a situation, how does an organization make its financing decisions, and what are the impacts, implications of these financing decisions on the company's valuation? That is what is being examined in this part. Second is capital market and capital structure in and value in a perfect world. Again, continuing the previous concept, how does an organization construct or decide upon the capital structure, decide upon the proportion of debt and equity in its capital structure? And there is always an issue of information asymmetry. Information asymmetry means not similar, not alike, not equal. You know, there are different players in a capital market. The two big set of players is the savers of funds, another one is the users of funds, or the lenders and borrowers, or the individuals and households which save and invest in corporate securities on the one side, and on the other side, corporates which want to raise the money by issuing securities. So these two are the users and the lenders, you can say, are the savers. And ideally, it is believed that these two sets of players in the capital market have the same information, same level, same degree, same amount, same extent of information, because everybody knows everything in the same fashion. It is not that the companies raising the capital know about the government policies and the users like me and you, or sorry, the savers like me and you do not know about the interest rate structures of the government policies on tax, etc. It is not like that. Every player in the organization, in the capital market has same information so that they will be able to take the decisions optimally or appropriately. But this is an ideal situation, but in the real world, there is always this information asymmetry. There is a big difference between the nature and the quantum of information a company has got and the nature and quantum of information an individual like me or you or a household or a retail investor has got. The companies would be having, because they have got access to a lot of information, they would be knowing better than individuals, individual savers, individual households about the capital market, about the financial market, about the global financial markets, about the government policies, etc. So there is always this information asymmetry. And this affects to a large extent the nature and the timing of the decisions made by the borrowers or users of capital, as well as the savers or the lenders of capital. And this has a lot of implications on the entire process of raising capital in the capital market. And finally, we have this new concept called share buyback, where an organization buys back its own shares. In the normal practice, this is not one way. A company cannot buy back its own shares, or a shareholder cannot sell back his holdings to the issuing company. If he does not want to hold the shares of that company, you know, he will have to go to the secondary market, he will have to go to the stock exchange, he will have to tell his broker to sell those shares and get the money. But in special rare circumstances, it is possible, or the companies are permitted to buy back their shares for various reasons, which we'll see in the latter part of this. So these are the contents of this unit. Are you following? Hello? Hello? Are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Hope you have not dozed off. Right? Now, let's go into the details of these contents, what I have introduced in the previous slide. At a fundamental level, at a basic level, at an introductory or the starting point, financing decisions compared to investment decisions are relatively easier to make and have a lesser impact on the value. So this is what we need to understand. We noted that there are three sets of decisions a financial manager takes: financing decisions, investment decisions, and dividend decisions. Of the first two decisions, that is financing decisions and investment decisions, financing decisions are found to be little easier, comparatively easier to take compared to the investment decisions, because in case of investment decisions, there is always this issue of its impact on the shareholders' value. You will have to examine different investment opportunities. You will have to evaluate them. You will have to project their future cash flows. You will have to find out their present value. You have to find out their net present value. Then you have to compare the net present value. If the net present value is negative, you are going to reject that investment opportunity or investment proposal. If there are multiple investment projects having positive net present value, then you have to select, you have to ration the capital, available capital. You will have to choose the highest NPV investment project, and in that order you will have to come down till you exhaust all your funds. So it is a very complex, multi-layered, multi-stage process, that is investment decisions. Compared to these investment decisions, the finance manager, the practicing managers have found that financing decisions, that is raising capital, decisions with respect to raising debt and equity from the capital market, are relatively easy to make. You don't encounter too much of complexities or challenges or problems in financing decisions. Now we are coming back to your financial management curriculum, where you had studied about capital structure decisions, capital structure theories, and one of the important set of theories is Modigliani and Miller's theory, or MM theory. This Modigliani and Miller's themselves were very confused a lot, so they have given two contradictory or opposite sets of theories. One is relevance theories and other one is irrelevance theories. According to relevance theory, first they are going to consider the relevance theory. Here we find that the market value of a firm is independent of its financial leverage. So this is irrelevance theory. The financing decisions, or the financial structure, or the capital structure, or the debt-equity ratio, debt-equity mix of an organization does not have any impact on the value of a firm. So as part of corporate valuation, we are examining the impact of this Modigliani Miller's irrelevance theory of capital structure. According to this theory, the market value of a firm is independent of, or is not dependent on, its financial leverage or its debt equity mix. You raise whatever amount of debt you want, whatever amount of equity you want, without having to worry about your decision's impact on your value. Value is independently arrived at, independently computed. The market value is a company, not entirely based on its capital mix, or capital financial mix, or capital structure, but based on various other factors. That is what this theory says. So in the context of strategic financial decisions, in the context of corporate valuation, we are required to consider some of these important theories, very history making theories. They are very important, very significant theories in financial management. So the financial leverage. Leverage is, you are aware, leverage is the use of debt capital in the capital structure or financing. Please be aware of the meaning of such basic terms. Leverage, leverage means the use of, presence of debt capital in the capital structure, debt capital in the financing structure of an organization. So what this irrelevance theory of Modigliani and Miller says is that your financial leverage, the degree of financial leverage is not going to affect the value. You need not break your head about this relationship. There is no such relationship between leverage and the value. So the leverage irrelevance theorem of MM is valid if the perfect market assumptions underlying their analysis are satisfied. So this you have already noted. I have already started getting the. So this I am not going into the details of this theory. You would have studied this in financial management, but this is very important. The entire theory of irrelevance of capital structure, irrelevance of financing decisions to the valuation of a company is based on the certain assumptions the authors have made. These assumptions relate to the existence of perfect capital market. If these assumptions hold good, if these assumptions are found to be present, only then capital structure or financing decision is not going to affect the value of the company. That we have to understand. The entire irrelevance theory of MM, that irrelevance of capital structure to the company's value, holds good only if and only when the perfect market assumptions or the assumptions made by MM about their irrelevance theory hold good or satisfied. If these assumptions are not satisfied, then the theory of MM won't be valid. And that means the capital structure continues to affect your valuation. So that is what we need to understand. So while studying this unit, please refresh your memory or knowledge of the capital structure theories which you had studied in financial management. We are not going into the details. We are only going to capture this summary of those theories so far as they relate to corporate valuation. So please note this. The leverage irrelevance theory of MM is valid or it will hold good. What is the irrelevance theory of MM? Irrelevance theory of MM says capital structure or financial leverage does not affect the company's value. This is the irrelevance theory. Or see the previous bullet. Market value of the firm is independent of financial leverage. This proposition will hold good or will become valid only if the perfect market assumptions made by the authors for their analysis hold good or are satisfied. If even one assumption is not satisfied, this irrelevance theory will not be valid. Will not be valid. This means the opposite of this, that is relevance theory, will become valid, which tells us, as we see in the next bullet or in the following bullet, that capital structure is relevant to the value, or the value is impacted by the capital structure. So we don't get confused. We need to understand both the issues, both the contradictory issues. One theory says capital structure affects value. Another theory says, another theory by the same authors, an improvised theory, says capital structure does not affect the value. Both theories are there. Our job is to understand that these two contradictory situations or propositions are there in the academic circle. However, in the face of imperfections or frictions characterizing the real world, capital structure of the firm may affect its value. That is what we say. Perfect market is a ideal or hypothetical situation. It is only in textbooks. But in the real world, there will be lot of imperfection in the financial market or capital market. You are aware of this. On account of the existence of imperfections in the capital market, or on account of the absence of or non-existence of an ideal capital market in the real world, we are going to the opposite end of this the situation, that is capital structure of the firm may affect its valuation. So if capital market is perfect, capital structure is not going to affect your value. But if the capital market is imperfect, which is the real case, which is in fact the real case, capital structure is going to affect the company's valuation. If you are able to remember these two things, probably you will be able to understand the whole story. Yeah, I am left with 5 minutes. Let me. And these are all about your theories. I am not going into the details of these theories. The major imperfections of the real world. In the previous slide, in the last bullet, we noted about certain market imperfections. We noted that there would be certain imperfections in the capital market, in the real world. Capital market is never a perfect market. It is always an imperfect market. Now, what are the major imperfections that we find in the real world? These are the taxes, the existence of taxes. The existence of tax make a lot of difference. You are aware, I think I need not again repeat this, but to summarize, the existence of corporate tax makes debt financing preferred over equity finance. Why and how, I am not going to details. I hope you are all aware of this, because interest paid on the debt, interest paid on borrowings, interest paid on debentures is tax deductible. To that extent, please don't annotate interest paid on debt or borrowings or loan is tax deductible. As a result, company is able to reduce its tax liability. As a result, company is able to increase its earning per share on EPS. As a result, company will be able to have a higher PE ratio. As a result, company will be able to have higher value for its shares. So that is one. Existence of tax and its impact. So existence of corporate tax, because one of the assumptions is that one of the assumptions of MM theory of irrelevance is that there are no taxes, but in the real world there are corporate taxes. You are aware of this. So existence of corporate tax makes debt financing preferred over equity financing. Similarly, there are other costs like financial distress. Debt is cheaper, but debt results in lot of financial distress, because if you are not able to service the debt, they might even bring the company to liquidation. You will have to manage the debt through a debenture deed and with a debenture trust, etc., etc., and there will be agency costs to manage this. So there are benefits of debt because of the taxes, but there are problems with the debt because of financial distress and agency costs. When these two opposite things are there, you will have to decide whether using the debt in the capital structure is really going to matter, is really going to help us improve our shareholders' value. So these are the imperfections we find on account of this, and the impact of taxes, as what I explained in the first bullet, is shown there, and you are aware of this one. I am not going into the details. So these are the imperfections we need to know. These three: existence of corporate tax, financial distress on account of debt financing, agency costs to manage the debt, compared to the costs to manage the equity. Because equity is by the promoters or the owners, there won't be much cost. But debt is from outsiders, you will have to manage, you will have to incur a lot of administration, maintaining accounts, servicing debt, etc. So then the agency cost. So there are benefits of debt, there are costs of debt. So you have to manage. So this is where I am going to stop, and you shall see the other part of the theory in the next session. So finally, 35 are there. Bhumika has joined. Who else? Anybody else? Adarsh ji has joined. Shantaram has come in. Pranam Hegde, Shweta Mary. I think I have named all those present. Are you able to hear me? Hello? Are you there?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I am ending this session now. I am ending this. Yes, thanks for attending. Yes, keep attending all the classes. Take care.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. All. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.